Hello everybody, we're Team 6, Bare Bits Beautyline. So today we're going to present our partners, starring production from Beautyline. This presentation focuses on the overall design and product of styling. First, we're going to talk about the general information, such as the location and capacity. Second, we're going to talk about product specification, and then we're going to talk about the process overview. Finally, we're going to talk about the economy and analysis. Our group is hired by Lion Chemicals, which we're gonna process the C4 streams into butadiene and then process butadiene to styrene. By look at those tables, we can see the price for the C4 is 17.6 cents per pound, and the price of styrene is 65 cents per pound, which is increased 3 times of the price for the styrene. So that, which means we can make triple profit if we turn C4 into styrene. Because the company have been doing all our projects too, so we have to make sure our design project is met, that pressure value over $30 million, and then after tax rate of return better than 20%. Next, we're gonna talk about the location we'll pick. We pick location at US Gulf Coast, specifically Houston, Texas. We picked this location because it's their shipping channels where there's a lot of access to many pipelines to access their supply materials. Also, there's a benefit you're choosing the US Gulf Coast because we lower our OBLs compared to the Northeast US. It's a 0.1 difference in the investment side factors. Next, we're going to talk about our fee. Our C4 fee entered at 100,000 pounds per hour with 53% of 1,3 butadiene, 24.5% of 1-butene, 21% of isobutylene, and other small percentage of the unpainting and butene and the propylene. Next, we're going to talk about how we turn C4 into butadiene and into styrene.
So our styrene project is produced through two reactions. In the first reaction, two molecules of 1,3-butadiene react with each other to form vinyl cyclohexane. And in the second reaction, vinyl cyclohexane react with oxygen to form our primary product, which is styrene, and also produce three byproducts, benzaldehyde, benzoic acid, and ethylbenzene. And we made the decision that we want to further purify benzoic acid and benzaldehyde so that it meets the product specification so we can sell them as products as well. And for styrene, we produce 45,463 pounds per hour styrene, and it meets all the product specifications. First of all, in order to be selling the market, the styrene purity needs to be higher than 99.8 weight percentage. And in the process we designed, our styrene product concentration has actually reached 99.93%, which achieved the goal. And for the impurities in the styrene product, the isobenzene concentration needs to be lower than 500 ppm, and our ethylbenzene concentration is kept lower than 46 ppm. And for alkene concentration, the target concentration should be lower than 100 ppm, and in our styrene product, the concentration of alkene is actually lower than 17 ppm. And for oxygenate, the target is lower than 100 ppm, and our impurity of oxygenates in styrene product is 2 ppm. And for water, the desired impurity concentration is lower than 100 ppm. And in our final styrene product, we actually found no water present in the product. And for the byproducts, in order for them to be sold in the market, their concentration should reach the target concentration. For benzoic acid, the target purity is 99.6 weight percent, and our production rate of benzoic acid is 1,036 pounds per hour. And for benzaldehyde, the target purity is 99.5 weight percent, and our production rate of benzaldehyde is 1,368 pounds per hour.
The process converts 85.8% of butadiene to styrene at a 99.8% purity. There are four major specs that we look for. One of them is process-driven selectivity, which we meet at 78%. The second one is styrene loss, which we also meet at less than 2%. We, however, do not meet an intermediate loss, which is vinyl cyclohexane, which the spec for it is less than 2%. However, we do meet the energy spent as a utility spec, which is less than 2,500 B2 per pound of product. So 1,3-butadiene is separated from the feed using an extractive distillation unit and dimethylformamide as our solvent. We picked dimethylformamide because it's based on research from industry standards. As you can see, there's a package cost and a design cost. We decided to use the design cost because the total spread over 15 years is $65 million less as for the design cost versus the actual package cost. And this is mostly dependent on the capital cost required for the package, so this is a huge saving we have from our economics. The process is run in multiple phases. The first phase involves separating the feed. So the feed involves using a column to separate the C4 impurities from the butadiene, and then the butadiene is further separated from the dimethylformamide in another column. It is also recycled back into the process. Then the process is furthered to a dimerization reaction from converting 1,3-butadiene to vinyl cyclohexane. This takes place in a packed bed reactor, after which another column is used to separate the vinyl cyclohexane and other products from the butadiene. Another column is used to separate the cyclooctane from the vinyl cyclohexane, and that's further used for the next phases of our process.
In the second half of our process, the vinyl cyclohexane produced in the first phase is mixed with oxygen and sent to a reactor where it is oxydehydrogenated to produce styrene as well as other side products. The reactor effluent is then sent to 2 3-phase separators in series, each of which produces 3 major phases, one primarily water, one primarily organics, and one primarily gases. Since the gas phase in the first separator contained a significant amount of styrene, the 2 separators were used in series and the styrene recycled. The organics from the first 3-phase separator were then sent on for further purification of styrene. The other important part of this process is that there was a significant amount of water produced in the second reactor, and so there's a significant amount of water that comes out of the 2 separators. These 2 water phases were both sent to further processing via distillation, and they were purified to the point where we could release the water to sewage, which reduced our waste costs. In the final part of our process, styrene is purified using 2 distillation columns, which remove side products, and styrene is purified to 99.8% in the distillate. 2 other parts of this process were added and were analyzed as our alternative cases to determine whether they would be profitable. The first is a vinyl cyclohexane recycle, in which the tops are recycled and the overall conversion of vinyl cyclohexane to styrene is increased. And the second part of the process includes adding 2 additional columns at the end of the process to purify benzoic acid and benzaldehyde. In doing so, not only were we able to meet the target purities of benzoic acid and benzaldehyde so we could sell them as side products, we were also able to purify an additional styrene stream to 99.8% in the distillate, allowing for further revenue. As mentioned, these 2 components of our process were analyzed as our alternate case studies. Our base case was shown on the previous slide. In case 1, we removed the vinyl cyclohexane recycle and those 2 corresponding columns. And in case 2, we removed the final 2 columns purifying our side products, benzaldehyde and benzoic acid. As you can see, there was a significant decrease in capital cost and utility cost when we removed these columns. Capital cost on the order of about $5 to $10 million, and utility cost about on the order of $1 to $4 million. However, this decrease in cost was outweighed by a lower production of styrene on our side products, which overall led to decreased profits. In case 1, where we removed the recycle, we were producing about 3,000 pounds per hour less of styrene. And in case 2, we weren't able to sell our side products because they weren't pure enough, and so we lost that additional revenue stream. So overall, when we looked at our after-tax return on investment, we saw that it was highest with the base case, which included the recycles and the side product purification, and less with the other 2 cases. Hence, we chose to proceed with the base case for our analysis.
With any business project, it's important to consider the capital cost and the operating costs. While the capital cost can be depreciated over time, it's operating costs which contribute to the plant's losses over the long run, and they should be scrutinized further if the plant wishes to increase their productivity. Therefore, we broke down our operating costs. Currently, our total operating costs stand at about 57 cents. Out of this, roughly 45 cents or 80% is composed of the feed. And another 9 0.5 cents, or roughly 10%, is composed of utility costs. While we cannot break down the feed costs much, we did try to break them down into the following components. Our feed can be broken down into the mixed C4 stream, which is further subdivided into the butadiene and the other C4s. While we are burning the C4s, so it is important to know that these also contribute to our net profit towards the end. And it is also important to note that the feed cannot be, we cannot control the price of the feed, which is dependent on the price of oil. If there is an increase in the price of oil, it does impact, it results in a very direct correlated increase in price of styrene, and Siddharth will talk about it later. However, it is important to note that to make our process more efficient, we have to make sure that our utility costs are under control, because an increase in utility costs, which is caused by an increase in gas prices, does not impact the price of styrene. Therefore, we broke down our utility costs into the following components. Hot oil, high pressure steam, low pressure steam, and so on. It is easy to see that hot oil contributes the biggest fraction to our utility costs. While we were designing our process, most of the hot oil was used to cool down the reactor 2, which produces a lot of energy. In order to make our process more efficient, we can recycle the hot oil, and so there is less need to purchase more of it, and it will then become our capital cost, which can be depreciated.
Our cost of utilities is based on the price of natural gas, so as the price of natural gas increases, so does our cost of utilities. Currently, our plant is modeled at a price of natural gas of $3 per million BTU. Since this is the average for the past 8 years, beginning here in 2010, if the price of natural gas were to increase while keeping all other costs the same, our plant is viable up to a price of $4.40 per million BTU of natural gas. Our plant would then be achieving an after-tax rate of return of 13% and having a payback period of 14 and a half years, which is just below our lifetime of 15 years. Any further increase, we would need to make some design changes to the process, or the price of styrene would also have to increase.
Yeah.
Fixed costs account for 8% of our cash cost, with property taxes being the most of them, accounting for up to a third. Currently, our labor has 4 shifts with 8 operators per shift, and since this accounts for a small portion of the overall cost, we do not see any need to cut personnel further than this, as the lower supervision may lead to more problems on the production line and more downtime. The timeline of our plant includes a 3-year construction period followed by 15 years of operating. The cash flow and net present value of our plant reached their lowest values at year 3, since that is when all the capital spending is done and we have no source of revenue yet. However, the cumulative cash flow becomes positive at year 6, or operating year 3. It continues to grow steady at about $20 to $30 million per year after that. Our net present value turns positive at year 8, or operating year 5, and continues to grow at a steadily decreasing rate until it reaches its final value of $53 million at the end of the plant's lifetime. Our required netback for 20% after-tax rate of return is currently over the market price, but just slightly. If we were to use the current market price of styrene at 65 cents per pound, our rate of return would be 19.8% and give us a 7-year payback period. The price of styrene could decrease to 61.9 cents per pound, and our plant would still be achieving a respectable 15 cent after-tax rate of return.
Continuing on with what Jake was saying, we essentially just ended up making a graph that would compare our rate of return to the payback period based on this the different price points that we could try using. And what we found is that at 62 cents per pound, where the rate of return was 15%, we'd actually see that the payback period was also around 15 years. So what we could conclude from that is that in order to be net positive at all, we would actually have to be selling our styrene at above 62 cents per pound. So going through with this, we decided to try and figure out what the price of styrene would be at this time based on the oil prices. And our estimations for the past series of years ended up saying that the styrene's actually going to be about 56.8 cents per pound, which is much lower than the price that we need to be selling our styrene at. And you can see that it sort of peaks around 2008, and then it sort of dips down, and now it's on a slow incline back up. So we decided to make the graph, we decided to have a larger look at the graph, and the graph that you're looking at over here is essentially the oil prices from the 1990s all the way up to present time. And what you can tell is this peak over here at 2008 coincides with the peak in the previous graph. So that kind of shows that they are connected in a way. And we estimated that to reach a styrene price where we would actually be profitable, we'd need to see this trend over here continue on a little further up to maybe 2025. So we can conclude from that right now it's probably not best to actually build the plant. But if we were to wait till 2025, we would be able to reach a styrene price point where we would actually be profitable. And you can tell that by the NPW, where if we were to start selling our styrene, or start building the plant and selling it at this time period, we'd actually end up making losses of around $40 million, versus if we were to wait a little bit, we'd actually end up being more profitable later on.
Thank you for your time, and we hope you take our recommendations into consideration when building our plant.